It is my pleasure right now to introduce the president and CEO of the Peoria Riverfront Museum, Mr. John Morris.
So, good evening. On a very special evening, looking out across this beautiful, extraordinary Illinois River that makes this Peoria Riverfront Museum the only museum of its kind in America. Art, science, history, achievement, and tonight, music. The only one. On behalf of the board of directors of the museum, who I am proud to serve, and through them to serve our community, and on behalf of the staff who work so hard to put together more and more inspirational events like tonight, I say welcome. Are there members of the board in the audience? If you'd raise your hands just so we can say thank you to all of what you do. Thank you so much. Tonight is a performance that helps celebrate an exhibition, which we are not a performance organization as the Peoria Riverfront Museum. We're an inspirational organization that uses every tool in the toolbox possible to lift people up. So we took an exhibition of the Thomas G. Newmiller poster collection, more than 8,000 strong, sponsored by the same generous folks who are sponsoring tonight's production. I want to start by recognizing Linda Beth and Ed Sutkowski, our sponsors tonight. So you just saw those extraordinary posters. Aren't they beautiful? Here's a story. Let me start with a story. There was a little boy born in South Bend, Indiana. His mother liked to celebrate music herself, good parenting, and this kid started martial arts when he was 4 years old, and then football, and then in high school, junior year, music, boom. He ended up going where three generations of his families had gone before to school, the University of Illinois, Champaign. Any U of I graduates in the house? Okay, you can cheer that, cheer that on. It's our flagship state school, and there he met a young lady who had been spent time in Germany and California with her family, but she too, after Dartmouth, had found her way to grad school at the University of Illinois. Boom. One of the greatest power music couples in America emerged out of the rich cornfields of Champaign-Urbana. And of course, this young man's name was Nathan Gunn. And Nathan would go on to perform in lead roles in the greatest opera houses all over the world, from the Met to San Francisco to the Lyric, all over Europe. And that former football player, he kept working out in the hotel room in between all of these things. This is a true story, sit-ups and pull-ups. I read he could do a lot of pull-ups at one time. Well, as it turns out, Luciano Pavarotti, one of the most beautiful singers ever, could not achieve what Nathan Gunn achieved. He was voted one of People magazine's sexiest men alive. 2008, for those of you who don't believe me. And I am quite confident the only opera star to ever make that list. And frankly, I've never met any of the sexiest people alive, so it's really pretty cool. so sought after in the great operas, including The Men, where Terry Terhune tonight, one of our guests, actually saw Nathan Gunn in one of his earliest performances when Terry lived in New York City. Is that incredible? Amazing. By the way, Terry, thank you for pointing that out tonight. I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but how amazing that from New York City, from the stage of the Metropolitan Opera, to here in our home state, Nathan Gunn. Julie Gunn with a doctorate in piano. So these two, the co-directors of the Lyric Theater at the University of Illinois, have brought here tonight, after Nathan guest curated this exhibition, they have brought with them five superstar students from their program. And what we are about to see is something, ladies and gentlemen, that has never been done before in the only place that could do it, the Peoria Riverfront Museum. So please help me give a warm standing welcome to the two of the greatest musical couple we have in America today and in Illinois, Julie and Nathan Gunn, and five of their star students.
Thank you. Wow, I think we're just gonna start. Singer, I stand on painted tape. It tells me where I'm going and where to throw my cape. I call my co-star's brother, I call my co-star's name. My talent feeds my darker side, yet no one will complain. I am an opera singer, I sing in foreign lands. I've sung for kings in Europe and emperors in Japan. Single morning, I'm ready to go by 10. I play both good and evil parts. I sing in Verdi's plays. I am an opera singer. I sing in foreign lands. Most people seem to know my name, or at least know who I am. Bet you didn't expect that, huh? So, welcome to Nathan Gunn Presents Nathan Gunn, and I'm Nathan Gunn. And this is Julie Gunn here at the piano, my lovely wife. Come on up here. Stand up here, yeah, I think that's better.
Thank you.
Is that on?
I did. Yeah, I meant to.
Let me go.
How'd I do?
No, talk on this. Okay. So, wow, what an introduction. My gosh. You know.
John has the best stories.
He has the best stories, and they're all, for the most part, true. So we are thrilled to be here again today at the wonderful Peoria Riverfront Museum. Thank you, John. Thank you, Linda. Thank you, Ed. And it's hard to believe that we opened this back in December. I'm sure some of you were here when we performed a number of songs, a number of arias, some show tunes that hopefully added some flavor to what you saw on the walls. And we thought, well, tonight, since we're sort of celebrating the closing of that exhibit, it's really hard for the two of us to do ensembles, one. And also we thought,
we could bring along some of our students from the Lyric Theatre Illinois program and showcase some of them as well.
So in December, if any of you were here, I think some of you were, we talked about how we learned about these great pieces. We looked at all the posters that Nathan curated, and then we picked our favorite pieces that we had a personal connection to. We talked about how we learned them and where we were and kind of told our life story through that. And now we're bringing them to the next generation. So this is like the sequel, part two of that, learning about opera. So we have five of our best students here today, sopranos, mezzos, tenors, and baritones, to sing with us. We have completely planned too much music.
We did, yeah. So as with, this often happens to us, so what you're looking at in the program doesn't really resemble what you're going to hear. It sort of does, but it's out of order.
It's the same six sections.
Yeah, otherwise you would have been sitting here for 3 hours, and I don't think anybody wants
that. We want to have the reception too, so. Anyway, we will talk to you as we go about each different piece, but we're going to start tonight with Carmen. We started a little bit with introduction to Nathan's piece of the Carmen. So we'd like to introduce our students. The first one is Vivica Richards, soprano.
And Salvatore Castronovo. Sal.
Mackenzie Taylor.
Hector Camacho Salazar.
And singing the habanera from Carmen, Alejandro Sandoval. Yeah. Yeah. accompanied by the locomotive. That was...
Everyone is a critic, right?
That was the flower song where Don José declares his love for Carmen. Don José has two women in his life, well, actually three. His mother that we hear about maybe in more detail than we'd like. He brings her a kiss from his mother, and they have a love duet. But this is Micaela. Vivica's playing Micaela. Micaela is a good person, and she has come to save Don José, and she's very scared. She's out in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the night, and she's praying for courage.
Thank you.
talk about first operas, Magic Flute is a first opera for many. It's a first opera for me to see, first opera for me to be in. In Nathan's case, how old were you when you were for the first time the Papageno?
Actually, the Magic Flute was the first opera that I ever heard, and it was the overture to it that made me start thinking about going into music. And that was when I was about 16 years old. So I've been living with this opera for a long time. And it was the first HD broadcast some of you may have seen from the Met was the Magic Flute in English. That was a first for me as well. And I've always told them that Papageno, that part, is one where you will have to, I will do it, you'll have to roll me out and I'll still do it. Just put me in a wheelchair and push me out on stage. But...
So the Metropolitan Opera, the HD broadcast that you do is Julie Taymor, the woman who directed The Lion King on Broadway, highest grossing musical ever, also directed this particular production on the Magic Flute. Very, very appealing, and lots of little kids come with their grandparents and see and they seek Papageno's autograph. Anyway, a big signature role for Nathan. Oh, it's that time. We knew this was going to happen, and I'm glad it's happening now. Anyway, like Nathan says, he wants to sing Papageno until he dies. But maybe sometimes it's time to make room for the next generation. So Papageno sings in this opera. He sings a suicide aria. Nobody takes it very seriously. He's always trying to get out of killing himself. He keeps counting, maybe someone will come help me. Oh, goodbye, cruel world. Oh. So anyway, he's sad because he can't find Papageno, who is his soulmate and other bird person. Anyway, today we thought maybe that Nathan could sing the suicide aria and then have Sal sing the love aria.
Yeah. Well, see, I've already found my Papageno, so he can be the youngster finding his. Yeah, I'm looking for more like Papa, looking for the grand Papagenos and Papagenos. So Sal will come out right after that to sing the duet, but I'll show up with the longing part, the suicides.
Meine Schöne, vergebens. Ach, sie ist verloren. Ich bin zum Unglück schon geboren. Ich plauderte. Und das war schlecht. Und drum geschieht es mir schon recht. Drum geschieht es mir schon recht. Seit ich gekostet diesen Wein, seit ich das schöne Weibchen sah, so brennt's im Herzenskämmerlein, so zwickt es hier, so zwickt es da. Papageno, Herzensweibchen, Papageno, liebes Täubchen. Es ist umsonst, es ist vergebens, bitte bitt ich meines Lebens. Sterben machte lieb ein End, wenn's im Herzen noch so brennt. Diesen Baum, da will ich zieren, mir an ihm den Hals zu schmieren, weil mein Leben mir missfällt. Gute Nacht, du falsche Welt, weil du böse an mir handelst, mir kein schönes Kind zu wandelst. So ist aus, so sterbe ich. Schöne Mädchen, denkt an mich, schöne Mädchen, denkt an mich. Will sich eine um mich armen, ich hänge noch erbarmen, wo soll lass ich diesmal sein? Rufet nur ja oder nein, rufet nur ja oder nein. Keiner hört mich, alle stille, 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 also ist es euer Wille. Papageno, frisch hinauf, ende deinen Lebenslauf. Papageno, frisch hinauf, ende deinen Lebenslauf. Nun, ich warte noch, es sei, ich warte noch. Nun, es sei, bis man zählt. Eins, zwei, drei. Eins. Zwei. Drei. Nun wohl an, es bleibt dabei. Nun wohl an, es bleibt dabei. Weil mich nichts zurückhält. Gute Nacht, du falsche Welt. Gute Nacht, du falsche Welt.
Okay, so now we're going to move along to Così fan tutte, which actually was another first. That was actually my, when I was a young artist, I think still. They have things at the Metropolitan Opera, most opera houses, called covers. And what you do is you study the role and hope that the person you're covering gets sick so you can go on, basically. And that's what happened for me. So I ended up doing my international debut on what was the Texaco broadcast, if you all remember that, singing the role of Guglielmo. But now that I'm 52 years old, I'm learning the role of Don Alfonso. So we're going to have these youngsters sing Guglielmo for me.
So there's a theme of the grumpy old man. Yes. In this. We've discovered it after we programmed it. Anyway, here, Don Alfonso, Nathan's the grumpy old man, is... So the basic story here is that these boys, the così fan tutte in Italian is in Italian, and it means in English, women are all like that. Kind of. And so these boys don't believe that. Don Alfonso thinks the women all, succumb to seducers. And they say, not our girlfriends. So they bet Don Alfonso some money, these two boys over there. And then they pretend to go to war and return disguised as Albanians.
Albanians from Albany.
People from Albany.
Totally unrecognizable.
What woman could ever see through that disguise?
No one could ever see through that disguise.
So anyway, their maid, Despina, played here by Mackenzie, is in cahoots with Don Alfonso to prove all of these young people kind of silly romantics. And this is where he introduces them to her.
Right, and then we'll move on to the duets right after that.
Then immediately they will try to seduce each other's girlfriends. Not a great thing for their friendship.
Because it works. And that's what, well, I mean, yeah, but it's got incredibly beautiful music in it. And the interesting thing about Così fan tutte is that nobody knows in the end whether they make up or whether the couples actually do switch, because they seem to be actually somewhat more suited for each other having switched. So that's the story.
Alla bella Desminetta, vi presento amici miei, non dipende che sa lei consolare il vostro cor.
Thank you.
dice Ferrando, oh che diletto. Il cuore vino no, è l'idolo mio, ma il vostro anch'io vi addate la me.
Lei davvero prendo, ma il mio non mi
Thank you. Oh, Okay, folks, this next piece from Così Fan Tutte, the trio, there we go, the trio, is really a benediction of sorts, and it happens at a time in the opera, oh, this is perfect. It happens at a time, while I'm talking, in the opera, actually a little bit earlier, where the boys were pretending to go off to war, and Don Alfonso is pretending as well, and their girlfriends are very sad. So it's sort of like a benediction. I think they call it the wafting. Yeah, the wafting trio. It's very beautiful.
So those were a lot of pieces by Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, who wrote in like the late 18th century. And one of the other great, great composers of opera that I'm sure you have heard much about is Giuseppe Verdi, the Italian composer who wrote through much of the 19th century and then retired. And then when he was like 89 and 90, wrote Otello and Falstaff. Two masterpieces, so there's still hope for many of us.
So we're doing one.
We're only doing one piece. We're doing Rigoletto Quartet. Here's the scene. The people over there on the left are a little bit less good than the people on the right. That's the Duke there in the red shirt. The Duke of Mantua. He's corrupt, oppressive nobility.
He looked like a duke.
And then Maddalena is, I think she's the owner of a wayside tavern. And she's not impressed by him. She knows exactly what he's like.
She's a mezzo.
But he thinks she's like very pretty. Yeah. And then we have the hunch, back to the grumpy old man story.
It's gotten worse.
He can't even stand up straight now.
Yeah, now he's a hunchback and he's he's here bringing his daughter to show that, hey, the Duke is actually not such a good guy. Look what he's doing with his, woman who owns this tavern over here. And she, of course, is?
She's shocked.
Shocked.
Because like in most stories, he's told her that he's a poor student and she's fallen in love with the Duke because he's been lying to her.
Do most of you know this story? Rigoletto, have you seen the opera before? Okay, I won't spoil the end. Well, a couple people. I won't spoil the ending then. You have to go see it. The ending is like the worst possible thing you could happen happens because it's opera, of course.
Okay. That doesn't happen in this quartet, though.
No, it doesn't.
But Gilda learns what she's dealing with.
Amen.
Okay, we'll turn to a little bit funnier stuff, if you can imagine. Are there any lawyers in the house?
Yeah, these are dedicated to you, just so you know.
So lawyer jokes are funny, and jokes about politicians are funny. So Gilbert and Sullivan wrote a lot of very funny shows, Pirates of Penzance, HMS Pinafore, Trial by Jury, etc., yeah. Back in the late 19th century, and brought them to America and toured with the Doily Cart Company. And that's the poster that you'll see in the, as I recall, in
that's
the
right.
exhibit, the Doily Cart. They were the producers. Anyway, they made fun of opera at the same time as making fun of the king and fake generals and unqualified bureaucrats.
Yeah, and lawyers, particularly.
And
lawyers. A lot of lawyers, yeah. It just never ends. The lawyer jokes have happened forever. Coming from a family of lawyers, I think I've heard them all, actually.
So this one's, Nathan's going to sing the I Am the Pirate King. And then Mackenzie's going to sing from Pirates of Penzance, Poor Wandering Ones.
Yes.
It makes fun of opera, like opera plots. Frederick finds out to his, he's so excited. He's the apprentice. He's been pressed upon a ship by some pirates until his 21st birthday. And then there's a twist in the plot. It turns out he was born on February 29th in a leap year. And he's not anywhere near his 21st birthday.
And they just beat that joke to death.
That's the entire plot.
That's the entire plot. So there you go. But it's funny, nonetheless.
And then Sal will sing, When I, Good Friends, Was Called to the Bar.
Yes, for our friend Ed here.
Far to live and die under the brave black flag I fly than to play a sanctimonious part with a pirate head and a pirate heart. Away to the cheating world go you, where pirates all are well to do, but I'll stay true to the song I sing and live and die a pirate king, for I am the pirate king, and it is a glorious thing to be the pirate king, for I am the pirate king, and it is a glorious thing to be the pirate king. Hurrah for the pirate king, hurrah for the pirate king. When I sally forth to seek my prey, I help myself in a royal way. I sink a few more ships, it's true, than a well-bred monarch ought to do. But many a king in his first-class throne, if he wants to call his crown his own, must somehow manage to break through. A more dirty work than e'er I do. For I am the pirate king.
I'm the pirate king.
It is a glorious thing to be the pirate king, for I am the pirate king. And it is a glorious thing to be the pirate king.
Hurrah for the pirate king,
hurrah for the pirate.
Fresh and hearty, but I was as many young barristers are, an impecunious party. I had a swallowtail coat of a beautiful blue, and a brief which I bought of a booby. A couple of shirts and a collar or two, and a ring that looked like a ruby.
And a couple of shirts and a collar or two, and a ring that looked like a ruby.
In Westminster Hall I danced a dance like a semi-despondent fury, for I thought I never should hit on a chance of addressing a British jury. But I soon got tired of third-class journeys and dinners of bread and water. So I fell in love with a rich attorney's elderly, ugly daughter.
We fell in love with a rich attorney's elderly, ugly
rich attorney, he jumped for joy and replied to my fond professions. You shall reap the reward of your pluck, my boy, at the Bailey and Middlesex sessions. You'll soon get used to a look, said he, and a very nice girl you'll find her. She may very well pass for 43 in the dusk with a light behind her. The rich attorney was good as his word, and the briefs came trooping gaily. And every day my voice was heard at the sessions of Ancient Bailey. All thieves who could my fees afford relied on my orations. And many a burglar I've restored to his friends and his relations.
And many a burglar he's restored to his friends and his relations.
At length I became as rich as the Gurneys, an incubus then I thought her. So I threw over that rich attorney's elderly, ugly daughter. The rich attorney, my character high, tried vainly to disparage.
No.
Yes! And now, if you please, I'm ready to try this breach of promise of marriage.
And now, if you please, he's ready to try this breach of promise of marriage.
For now I'm a judge.
And a good judge, too.
Yes, now I'm a judge.
And a good judge, too.
Though all my law be fudge, yet I'll never, never budge, but I'll live and die a judge.
And a good judge, too.
It was managed by a job. It was managed by a job. It is patent to the mob that my being made a knob was affected by a job and a good job.
So our last opera of the night. They're coming back.
Okay.
I hope they're coming back. Last opera of the night is Die Fledermaus. What's that about?
She's asking me. I have no idea. No, I'm kidding. So it's Die Fledermaus. It means the bat. And it's a typical Viennese operetta, meaning basically there's dialogue. And it's more like a musical theater piece in the sense that it's driven by plot. It's almost always funny. And in this particular situation, you'll see, what's first, the trio?
There's a trio.
Which happens first, right? And what is happening here is they're all going to the same party, but they're lying to each other about going, because they all want to go without the other person. And then the second, and then the duet, you want to explain the duet?
Yeah, so the duet is the first one is the maid, Adele.
Right.
The husband, Eisenstein, and the wife, Rosalinda. Right. And then the second time, then they get to the party.
Then they get to the party, and it's the wife and the husband singing the duet, but they're in disguise because it's a costume party, and the husband doesn't know it's the wife, and she recognizes him, and he starts to try to seduce her with this fancy watch he has. And so she says, ha-ha, I'm gonna get you by stealing your watch so I can prove that you tried to be a scoundrel. And she does. And then we have the finale. Then we have the finale. All right. And she's trying to find her music. All right, the trio from Die Fledermaus.
My husband there.
Start. Now let us count without delay.
Yes, right away.
myself completely.
Come to the end of the evening, and so just like, well, there we go. As the clock tells us, it's time for us to stop. So as with most operettas, everything ends up working just fine. All they need is a little bit of champagne, and everything is forgiven. So this is our last piece. It's Finale from Die Fledermaus.
Champagne is so majestic, tra-la-la-la-la-la-la, foreign and domestic, tra-la-la-la-la-la-la. It makes the world we live in a better place to give in. All for our folly fellers should keep it in their cellars. We toast champagne, the essence of the essence, the king of effervescence. You kiss me, I kiss you, you.
Okay, folks. Now, Julie, can you find, we got a special request from Linda, Some Enchanted Evening from South Pacific. So I'm gonna go into my place and pull that music out. Julie, could you find a copy?
Enchanted evening, you may see a stranger, you may see a stranger across a crowded room, and somehow you know even then, that somewhere you'll see enchanted evening, someone may be laughing, you may hear her laughing across a crowded room, and night after night, as strange as it seems, the sound of her laughter will sing in your dreams. Who can explain it? Who can tell you why? Fools give you reasons, wise men never try. Some enchanted evening, when you find your true love, when you feel her call you across a crowded room, then fly to her side and make her your own. Or all through your life you may dream all alone. Once you have found her, never let her go. Once you have found her, never let her go.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, what a night! What a night! So, of you are invited to celebrate with our performers in a reception afterwards. Julie and Nathan are going to hang around to say hello to everybody who would like it. We are joined tonight by 101-year-old Harriet Swager in the front row. God bless you, Harriet Swager. We have a mother of one of our performers who's flown in from New York to see your son. Wave your hand. Welcome to Peoria. Your son has a bright career ahead of him, but what must it be like for him to have started at the pinnacle, the Peoria Riverfront Museum? Right there, Mom. Welcome from New York. So, and most importantly, come here, Linda Beth Sutkowski and Jenny Parkers. Let's hear it for Linda, who has led this whole thing today and brought us all. And Ed, thank you. So, look, perhaps most important of all, Nathan Gunn's in-laws and Julie's mother and father are with us today, right there. Mom and Dad. Let me say this on behalf of our board of directors and our foundation board and our president's advisory council and our visionary society and so many of you who support this extraordinary institution. There's good news. Julie and Nathan Gunn are going to continue to be our advisors for performance at the Peoria Riverfront Museum. And they are friends we're going to keep, ladies and gentlemen. God bless you all. Thanks for coming. Ed, Linda, thank you very much. And please join us for a reception to meet the Guns and our fine performers. Can the students just introduce themselves and where they're from? Let's do that. Thank you.
I think I broke it. Oh, there we go. Oh. Make one other announcement, Julie.
I'm trying. Okay, here I am. We want to introduce the students. I can do that. I think I can do that. I want to invite you to Champaign next week. No, next week's Easter. Week after that, the 13th, 14th, and 15th, their compatriots are doing a show called The City of Angels. Right, Jason? Yes, City of Angels.
At
the Virginia Theater in Champaign. It's about an homage to film noir with a jazz score from the guy who wrote, the song, Hey Big Spender. There we go. It's great. Come see us. Okay. Sal Castronovo. Yeah. Hector Camacho Salazar. Alejandra Sandoval Montanez. Vivica Richards. And Mackenzie Taylor. Thanks for having us, everybody.
Thank you, everybody. Good night.